The form submission step has recently added some new settings that make it very powerful for working with confirmations and letting your end users have the perception that it's all one continuous flow, even though you may be setting it up between multiple forms. So we've set up an example on the demo site that I'll walk through first, and then I'll show you a little bit more advanced version using the same features and how on the back end that is set up, so you can set that up for your own environment. So in the case of our demo, it's a relatively straightforward example. And when the form submission step fires, it's copying the data from there into our second form. Now you can see on the link that we have here, the entry as we go to it, not only identifies what the parent entry ID is for the initial submission, but it also has the workflow hash to secure this particular page so that only the email based account is able to see that. And then we have additional options that we can modify in this second form. And that would also send us copies of that data in that scenario. So that lets the user see that it's a very straightforward process. They don't necessarily know which form they're working through other than what we've got in terms of the form titles. But we want to look at a little bit more of an advanced sample. So in this case, it's actually going to be triggering a couple of different form submission steps. And the idea that it's modeled off of is a maybe a job application or a volunteer services department. So they could select different services in this case. And like the first demo, that we have the option to take them directly to a second form. And that form is very different in terms of what we're asking. So we're still copying over the name and email information, but we also then have, in this case, modeled on some sort of an event that they can list their qualifications. I'll show you as we go, sort of moving back and forth between two environments here. So we have their initial entry that has been submit on the application. And when I go and look at that, we see the initial data that they had submit, as well as we have a field for the entry ID. So two things are happening here. On the initial application form, we have the qualifications form submission. And in it, we've used conditional logic to confirm that if they've selected that they have FHIR capabilities, that that's where we want this form submission to occur. We've assigned it to the email field, and we've gone through and said which field should be displayed. But the most important part is what field mappings occur. So we've taken the entry ID of the parent initial form and put that into a primary application ID field, which is just a text field, on the qualifications form, along with mapping the name and email. So what this allows us to do is, on the qualifications form, when we look at its workflow, the first step that we have is another one of the form connector steps to update an entry. And what this does is it updates the, as I've called it, main fields here. But the association is that it's going back to the using that primary application ID and storing the entry of this second qualifications form back into the main form in FHIR entry. So that if I go and look at that again, on the application, we know the entry ID that corresponds to their qualifications form. And when I go to the qualifications form, I also have this primary entry ID that associates to the initial entry. So as the user then goes through completing their forms, we also can have separate workflows that are now spawned for those. So in this case, I've set everything up as if it's a single administrator, but you can see that the qualifications form has its own workflow. And just that, and that update main field step is the first that we were looking in it. So they now have an option of user input and approval. And at the end of that process, there's additional data that gets mapped from this qualifications form back to the parent entry. So the analogy might be in this case that you're setting up an interview. And we've set this example so that you could save and continue to repeat based on when they're completing that interview, perhaps. But the main analogy in this that's important is there's something that you want to take from this subform and pass that back up to the parent form. So when the workflow for the subform goes through, we also added an approval step and completes its overall workflow. When we then come back to the entry on the main form, not only do we still have the fire entry ID, but also that qualification has come back. So if you have technical reviews, or maybe it's a job proposal or a campaign grant writing process, there's, you can spawn off the different subforms and then have the relevant summary data get pulled back up into the main one for its workflow to continue processing. In terms of how this is set up, when we go and look at the initial confirmation, we have two things that are in place here. The first one and most important to understand is it's using the workflow form submission link, but we're also being prescriptive in saying which assignee should that link be generated based upon and what step should it be based upon. And though the assignee field, our documentation has a couple different items, and it maps very closely to what you would be used to with the step assignee field. You can either say that it's based on a an individual user ID, and so it would be a user ID pipe and the user ID number. It could be a user field, in which case you're specifying the field number, or it could be an assignee field, in which case you're also specifying the field number. And along with that, you're specifying the step ID of the form submission step. And that the combination of values allows the, when the merge tag is processed during the confirmation, it generates the unique link for that assignee for that step. And that's how you saw that converting out. The Gravity Forms short code, they also have what they call a conditional short code, where you can look and identify to only display what occurs inside that conditional short code if the condition is met. So in this case, asking and verifying that the volunteer services field contains the value of fire ensures that we would want to, that's the scenario in which we want to give them the link to go and complete that qualifications form underneath. In addition to that happening by the confirmation screen, the notifications on the individual steps can also use that. So I've got a secondary qualification form, in this case food services, where the link is generated for it. And if I copy that into another window, because the form submission step for, in this case, the fire qualifications has been completed, this link is now relevant or will resolve properly. And what I mean by that is in our workflow, we have the two steps. The merge tag will try and generate a link based on whichever step you provide in those additional parameters. But whenever the user goes to click on it, the step, the workflow has to be on that step in order for the link to work. So as you can see now, it's got the one entry in the food services form. But if I go to the proper window and submit that, when I come back to this food services email, which was the original one I had received, and I try to action it at that point, I'm going to get a message that indicates it's not possible because the workflow has already moved past that particular form submission step. And it's saying that the link's no longer valid. So hopefully that gives you a better understanding of some of the power that not only the form submission step has, but the values that the merge tag present, and through some of the customized parameters, how you can give your users a perception of a single linear flow, but you're actually spawning off multiple different forms and workflows that behind the scenes you can be actioning separately.